Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message, and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John begins a new series entitled, The Responsibility of Mankind. What do you know about the creation of the angels, the universe, and mankind? Do you know that God created the angels long before the universe came into existence? Do you know the earth was populated by some type of people prior to Adam and Eve, and that there were cities, nations, commerce, and war? Do you know there was an angelic space war that stretched across the universe, and at the trial afterwards, Lucifer was sentenced to the lake of fire? What is the purpose of humanity? Why did God place Adam and Eve on the earth? This message will connect all the dots and answer any questions you might have. It is entitled, Pre-Adamic History. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church. And the message that I'm going to bring today is going to be very, very important. Pre-Adamic history. I want to pray first before I get into the message. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank and praise you right now for having these moments here, Lord, to bring forth truth for the Bible. And I thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit touching me right now. That Father God, I will be speaking the words that you want me to speak. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, I wrote this in my outline. There is always a job description associated with a job. When you're called in for an interview, you expect to receive a brief history of the company, its goals, and what they expect from you. The same holds true for every person living on the planet Earth. Most people have no clue as to why they were born, the history of the Earth. Is there a superior being who has controls all things, and what happens at the time of death? The only place to find all the answers to these questions is in the Bible. Now, I've been a Christian since 1965. I've been a practicing Christian since 65. I was born again when I was 3. But I can count my life as a Christian from 1965. And most of the time, you hear from the pulpit, people say, you know, well, why did God create man? Well, God was lonely, and he needed some company. Why are we here on this earth? Well, we really don't know. Why did Jesus die on the cross? Why did we need to get saved? But, you know, if you really ask a person, why? What happened prior to Adam and Eve? Was there something prior to Adam and Eve? They simply would say, I don't know. The problem in the church is this. We have a certain doctrine that has been put down for years. It's passed from generation to generation. And because of that doctrine, you have to toe the line. If you ask a question, what about this or that? And you back it up with the Bible, people say, or actually pastors say, and denomination leaders says, you can't go there if you don't believe that. But I'm going to give you today a biblical history lesson why you are here. What happened before Adam and Eve were created, and what's going to go on in eternity. Let's begin by turning to the book of Isaiah, chapter 45. That's Isaiah, chapter 45. We're going to begin in verse number 21. And here's what I want to settle now, once and for all. There is only one God. He is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. There are no other gods. There's no one above him, besides him. He doesn't have any brothers, cousins. There is only one God. And the Bible clearly states that. In verse 21, we read this. Tell you and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together, which declare this from ancient time, who is told it from the time, have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. Look unto me and be you saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God, and there is none else. And then we read in the next chapter, verse number 9, 46:9. Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning, from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. There's a lot of things we don't understand. So the question is this. How long has God existed? The answer is always. He has no beginning. He has no end. He is supreme. He's all-powerful. He can do whatever he wants. He travels in time. Time does not exist for God. Right now, God sees the beginning of the creation. He sees the end of it. He sees the whole thing in one sweep, constantly. Our God is superior to us. We cannot even be compared to him. And so you have a God that is unlimited knowledge, unlimited wisdom, unlimited power, never run out of power, never run out of energy. This is something that you and I cannot understand because everything we have is finite. If you have gasoline, coal, whatever it is, food, everything comes to an end. Our lives come to an end. God's eternal has always existed, and he always will. That's our God. You got to accept that by faith. And otherwise, you will not go any place. God is triune. The Bible tells us that he is known as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He is one and three at the same time. Let's turn to John chapter 14. That's the Gospel of John chapter 14. I'm going to pick it up here in verse number 8. That's John 14. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 8. And here we go. Philip says unto him, that's to Jesus, Lord, show us the Father, and it suffices us. Jesus said to him, have I been so long time with you? And yet have you not known me, Philip? He that has seen me has seen the Father. How do you say then, show us the Father? Believe you not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak to myself. But the Father dwells in me, he does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, who has believed me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I said to you, he that believes on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. God is triune. You and I are triune. You have a body, a soul, and if you're born again, a spirit is alive. If you're unsaved, you have a body, a soul, and a dead spirit. God is triune. He made us in his image. And you have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You and I cannot divide ourselves up. If I'm standing here and preaching today, my soul is here, my spirit is here. I am here totally in three persons. I cannot divide myself up. God can. Now God simply, as the Father, stayed in heaven. Jesus, the Son, came down to this earth. And the Holy Spirit is the one that communicated between Jesus on earth and the Father in heaven. They were operating as three different entities, and yet they are one. God has his capacity to divide himself up into three beings. Now, in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, it tells us this, that at the very end, Jesus and the Holy Spirit will merge back with the Father, and he will be in his full glory and full power when he meets us in the new creation. This third thing that we need to know is this. Jesus is the creator. God the Father did not create anything. Jesus is a creator. Let's turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 1. And we read a few verses there. It's the Gospel of John, chapter 1, and verse 1. In the beginning was a Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. In verse 14 we read, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, the glories of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus is the creator. God simply said this to the Father, I'm going to use the part of me, the Son, to do the creation. So when you read the Old Testament, a lot of people says, well, you know, that's not Jesus. You better believe that Jesus. It was Jesus that created Adam and Eve. Jesus that walked with them. Jesus walked with Abraham. Jesus walked with Moses. It was Jesus all the way in the Old Testament. And Jesus is the one that gave the Ten Commandments. Jesus is the one that gave all the laws to Moses, as recorded in the five books of Moses. Jesus did that. Let's turn to Colossians chapter 1. The little book of Colossians. And we're going to go to chapter 1. And I'm going to read to you from verse 12 through 19. Giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, which delivered us from the power of darkness, has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him, Jesus, were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether it be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. A lot of people talk about baby Jesus. Well, this is when Jesus was incarnated in the physical body, so he could live on earth, pay for our sins, and die on the cross. But I want you to see Jesus today as the creator. Yes, he was here as baby Jesus. He was here as a man for 33 and a half years. He died on the cross, rose on the third day. He's now resurrected and had gone back to his full power. But Jesus is God. He is a creator. And so when you read the Old Testament and the New Testament, you have to understand he is the author of both of them. A lot of people says, well, I'm just a New Testament. I'm saved by grace. you know, I'm just going to follow what the New Testament says. Jesus said, if you love me, John 14:6, 14:8, if you love me, keep my commandments. Let me get that right. That's the Gospel of John, chapter 14, and it is in verse number 15. I knew I was wrong. John 14:15, if you love me, keep my commandments, old and new. So your argument says, well, I'm saved by grace. Yes, you are. You're saved by grace. You're not saved by keeping the law. But Jesus never said, live like hell, do whatever you want to do. You're saved by grace. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. You read the New Testament. He talks about holy life, to live a holy life, to be obedient. So we keep the law, we keep God's words, because we are saved, not to be saved. Then point number four in my outline. Jesus created the angels before he created the universe. So let's turn to Job. That's the book of Job and chapter 38. The book of Job, chapter 38. And I want you to understand this. Before Jesus started the creation, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, God simply talked to himself. He laid out the entire creation, how to be done. It was done in his mind. Just like you take an engineer today who might design an automobile. They don't use drawing boards anymore. It's all in the computers. And they simply designed it in the computer. Virtual reality, three-dimensional. And they see everything, they test everything. And then when they are happy with it, they begin to print out the plans so that people can make the parts to build that. So God did not simply say, okay, we're going to try to do a creation. Let's throw this out and do this and that. No. He, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost sat down. How long? I don't know. Bible doesn't say. And they laid out every detail of the creation. Everything. Including the people to be born, what century they would be born in, whose parents they would have, what nation they would live. Nothing is haphazard. Everything is designed to the very smallest detail. They decided to create the angels first, because they wanted to use the angels to be part of the creation. That does not mean that God is not capable. You got to understand, I preached this before. God delegates. He creates beings. He makes them into what he wants them to be. And he says, I want you to do this. I want you to do that. So the angels were created first. Let's read Job chapter 38, the first 7 verses. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that is dark in counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up now your loins like a man, for I will demand of you and answer you me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Declare if you have understanding. Who has laid the meshes thereof, if you know, and who has stretched a line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened, or laid a cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang together, and the sons of God shouted for joy. The sons of God here refers to angels. The angels were created, and then they watched God create this universe. And the Bible says they shouted for joy. As a soul the stars, the planets, the constellations, the galaxies, the superclusters, when they saw all that come into being, they shouted for joy. Notice this, that before God even created the angels, he designed the spiritual laws that was to govern this creation and the next. He designed the mathematical laws, chemistry laws, physical laws, electrical laws, everything that has existence of technology. Everything is moving according to laws that we can figure out if you follow them. All of that was designed by God before the creation started. Now, once God had created the angels and the universe was complete, how long this took, we do not know. Now, let me give a little verse here. This is a bonus scripture here from Genesis chapter 1. Because I feel in my spirit that some people say, are you not a creationist? You don't believe in Genesis chapter 1? Yes, I'm a creationist. I believe in Genesis chapter 1. But there are two stories. There are two accounts in Genesis chapter 1. Let's read the first verse. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. It was complete. Sentence. It was done. But you read in verse number 2 that the earth was destroyed without form and void. Darkness was upon the earth. And you wonder, did God create it that way? No. Verses 2 and the rest of the chapter is the recreation story of the planet Earth after the space war and the destruction that took place. So we had a complete creation. The angels were placed and given different planets. Now they're in a different dimension than we are. They're in a spirit dimension, we had a physical dimension. But in the spirit world, they are solid. They have solid bodies. And the Bible says that there are angel civilizations on all over the universe in the different solar system planets. And they have created nations. They do commerce. They have all kind of things happening. Their technology is vaster than ours. They're able to travel in space. They travel faster than the speed of light. They did a lot of things they do. So if you and I could move into the spirit world, you will find that the universe is full of angels, high civilization, that are moving and doing work on their different planets. Point number 5. Jesus created the universe from things not seen. Let's turn to Hebrews 11:3. That's the book of Hebrews, chapter 11. And I'm going to start in verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 1. And I'll read this. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the Father by the prophets, has in these last days spoken us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, from also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Jesus is upholding all things. Now let's move now to chapter 11 in Hebrews. And we're going to pick it up in verse number. Let me see what I want to go. I want to go to Hebrews 11, 1 through 3. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtain a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. What did God use when he created the universe? He used energy. We know this from 2 Peter and also in several places in the Bible, that at the very end, the entire universe is going to be dissolved. Peter tells us the very elements, which is the name for atoms, the very atoms will be dissolved, not burn up, but dissolved. One thing they had learned, that was one of the first things I learned when I went to engineering school, college, and that is that energy is indestructible. You cannot destroy energy. You can move it from one form to the other, but you never destroy it. The lowest form of energy is heat. And eventually, energy goes back to heat. What is energy? It's a substance we cannot see. If you ask somebody, what is electricity? Well, we can say, well, these are electrons that are moving. We can calculate and so on. But in reality, if you ask now, what really is the power in electricity? No one can answer that. I never learned that when I was in college. I looked for it, but no one knows. It's an energy. We know how to use it, but we really can't explain it. God created energy. And out of energy, he spoke. And he created a universe. Incredible. When I was in college, I had to learn the periodical chart. That's in chemistry. And I did not understand it. Had a hard time. When I got saved, it was like a light bulb went on and understood the periodical chart. Here's a fantastic truth. Everything God created is from energy. He made atoms. What is an atom? It consists, if I can use a term, balls. You have a proton, a neutron, an electron. That's the simplest one we have. Hydrogen, the gas. Now, if you go to the next substance up, all God did was he just added another ball or two balls. And if you look at the periodical chart and see the atomic structure, all God did was, the only thing that differentiated is more balls, less balls. God created the entire universe with one particle, the atom. And out of the atom, he made gold, silver, all kind of things. It's a fantastic, I mean, if you think about the genius behind the creation, it is incredible. And it's all governed by mathematical laws. Now, at the very end, when Jesus come back, after the great white throne judgment, we're going to be moved to the new creation. There's another universe, parallel with this one, existing someplace, hanging in nowhere. And this one will be dissolved. This is where sin reigned. Nothing will survive. It will go back to raw energy. And it will, nothing that we have made here, lived on, will exist. not even the finest paintings. God's not going to bring anything out of it. Not even our physical bodies. We're going to get new bodies. The only thing coming out of here is your soul and spirit if you're born again. And if you're not born again, you're going to go to the lake of fire where your soul and dead spirit will live forever. And the lake of fire is going to be a closed system, hanging someplace in a space where no one is going to get to it. No one can get out, no one can get in, but it will exist forever. Let's go to part number 6 now. There was a rebellion in heaven when Lucifer simply rebelled against God. I'm not going to go to Isaiah and Ezekiel today. I'm just going to go to the book of Revelation. It's the book of Revelation, and we're going to look upon chapter 12. I've preached on this many times, so it should be familiar with you. In Revelation chapter 12, we read this from verse number 7. And there was, past tense, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon fought against his angels and prevailed not. Neither was a place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil. And Satan would deceive the whole world. He was cast out in the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And heard a loud voice say in heaven, now has come salvation, strength, and the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth, of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knows that he has but a short time. To abbreviate this, because I don't want to spend too much time on this subject, Lucifer was created, and he had access to the throne room. Let's get another information in here. We have the first heaven, but the Bible describes first heaven is the atmosphere. The second heaven is the universe. The third heaven is outside our universe, outside creation, where God resides, where his capital is, the city of God. And he has his throne room there. And this is where Lucifer had access to. He was leading the angels in worship. His home planet was the earth. And he had built a civilization on earth. Nations, there were people here, all kind of things you find in Isaiah and also in Ezekiel. One day, Lucifer decided, I'm tired of leading angels in worship. I'm tired of looking at God up on his throne. I want to be like him. I'm going to be like him. He reached in his mind. Of course, God knew that. He knew it before the creation. When God created the angels, they had a free will. There was no redemption for them. They could rebel or they could be loyal. Once they rebelled, there was no return for them. They could not be redeemed. They knew if they rebelled, it was over. Lucifer went back to earth, and then he traveled, whatever means he had to travel through the universe. And I want to understand something now. Our universe is more than 100 million light years in scope. If you travel by the speed of light, 186,000 miles a second. It takes hundreds of millions of years to go from one end to the other. The angels travel at an enormous amount of speed, way beyond the speed of light. The speed of light is like somebody walking compared to somebody flying a rocket 11,000 miles per hour. Now, Lucifer traveled to every angel civilization. He landed on the planets, and he simply got off, and he began to speak. They have television, radio, whatever they have, communication. And he spoke to every civilization and said, "Aren't you tired of being servants to that God that sits in the third heaven? Don't you want to be free? Don't you want to do what you want to do, not told what to do?" Does it sound familiar to you? As the devil talks today. One third of the angels in all different civilizations decided Lucifer is a man to go for. He's not a man, but the angel to go for. And they joined him. How long they were to build a space fleet, get their weapons ready, I don't know. But one day, the largest space fleet ever produced lifted from the different planets and headed for outside the universe, the city of God. They were going to go there, and they were going to dethrone God. God knew it. He had his archangel, Michael, commander-in-chief. God had built his own space fleet. And I want you to understand now about delegation. God the Father, when he saw Lucifer rebel, could have said, "I'll wipe him out." He didn't do that. Angels are created eternally. Once they're created, they live forever. God could have destroyed him. Didn't do it. God could have stopped rebellion. God didn't do that. God allowed him to go through the universe. He allowed him to build a space fleet. He allowed him to come against the throne room to attack him. That's when God said, "Enough is enough." And the war began. Of course, Lucifer and his fleet never made it to the third heaven. They were thwarted. They fell back to the different planet civilizations. And there was a war that raged from every planet that had rebelled. A tremendous war. But God's holy angels fought from solar system to solar system. And finally, they had corralled Lucifer, all his fallen angels, to the earth, to the solar system. If you look upon the planets here, Mars, Pluto, the moon, you find the surface destroyed, craters all over the place. It was a hard battle, and eventually, Lucifer was defeated, he was captured, his space fleet destroyed, all the fallen angels were arrested and brought to trial. Turn with me to Matthew 25:41. That's Matthew 25:41. Matthew 25:41. Have you read this? This is Jesus speaking. "Then shall he say also to them on the left hand, Depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels." God had created the lake of fire, not for man, but for the devil and his angels. They were brought to a trial. We don't have any record of that in the Bible. We know that there was a sentence. And if you read Job chapter 1 and 2, we know there's a courthouse in heaven, in the second heaven, where Satan goes, his angels go to accuse men. In that courthouse, there stood Lucifer, the fallen angels, trillions, zillions of them. God's holy angels were watching. And there, Lucifer was tried and sentenced to the lake of fire. Every fallen angel sentenced to the lake of fire. When the trial was over, Lucifer spoke. Jesus was presiding in the trial. And he said, "How can a loving God cast his creatures into everlasting torment? Is that love?" He blamed God on his own rebellion. And this is the key point of this whole message. God was accused before the holy angels, the fallen angels. A doubt was planted in their minds. Is God righteous? Or is this God's fault? God could not leave that question unanswered. If he did, he will not be able to move into his next creation. He would have to destroy everything and start from scratch. God stayed the sentence, confined Lucifer to the planet Earth with his fallen angels. This is a prison planet. And then God simply started the recreation. Let's read from Genesis 1:28. And I'm not giving too many details here today. I've done it before. And I want to put this in one message. In Genesis 1:28, we read this. "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created them, male and female created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish." That means that something had been there before. Replenish the earth, and subdue it. Had dominion over the fish of the sea, or the fowl of the air, over every living thing that moves upon the earth. If you really think about it, if there was nothing before Adam and Eve, why would God create a perfect garden, trees, plants, and everything, perfect climate? Create Adam and Eve, put them in the garden, and then put in one tree. Tree of knowledge of good and evil. And tell them this. You can eat of everything except that one tree. If you eat of that, you will die. Logic would tell you this. If I was a creator, and I wanted to have human beings to multiply on the earth and serve me, I wouldn't put that tree in there because I didn't want to tempt them. Adam and Eve were created sinless. They had a body, soul, and a spirit. They were spiritually alive. Why would I put in something that would be destructive for them? Think. It was put in there because they were to be tempted. This is part of God's plan. To show his righteousness. And who came in the garden? the serpent. Who was the serpent? There was a devil that inhabited the body of the snake. The snake could talk in those days before. God held the snake responsible for allowing Satan to use his body. He was punished. And there in the garden, all angels on earth that were fallen, all God's holy angels watched. And they saw Adam and Eve by their own free will sin. They saw Lucifer doing the same thing to mankind as he'd done to all the angel civilizations. Notice now, he didn't go to Adam. He went to Eve. He seduced Eve, the weaker vessel. And Eve seduced Adam. And they fell. And the earth was put back under sin. In Romans chapter 5, verse number 8. That's Romans chapter 5, verse number 8. God knew that man would fall. And he made a provision for man. Salvation. And I want you to understand this. Life is not fair. I did not ask to be born. I did not ask to be born as a man or a girl as a woman. This is what we are made for. God made us. God was not lonely. God made Adam and Eve to prove his righteousness to the entire angel civilization that if somebody sinned, don't blame it on God. It's the person, it's the angel that make that decision. He is responsible, not God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Let me flip back. I'm going to go back to Romans, but let me go to Romans chapter 3 and just read this to you here. And I'm going to read this from verses number 24. That's Romans 3, 24. Being justified freely by his grace, through redemption is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just, and the just for him that believes in Jesus. We are created to show that God is righteous. Most people will never be saved. Most people never were saved. I would say that 90% of the human race will end up in a lake of fire. Is it fair? I would say the blame is on ourselves. Adam and Eve, after they sinned, were given a truth. They taught their boys how to sacrifice. They were told about the coming Messiah, the Redeemer. All throughout the Old Testament, they were looking forward to the Redeemer. They knew that. But most people made a choice to leave God and to follow Lucifer. Noah had full knowledge. His three sons, only eight people after the flood. They begin to tell their descendants what happened. They told them about the Messiah. But most people said, no, I go with Lucifer. And they got into idolatry. It is not God's fault that 90% of the human race is ending up in the lake of fire. It is man's fault. Adam and Eve failed to preach their sons grandsons, and so on failed to obey God. The children of Noah failed to obey God. When a man sins, it is his own problem. He made a choice. We have a conscience inside of us. We know what is right and we know what is wrong. It's a tragedy. That's why you, watching me right now, or listening, should simply say, hallelujah, praise the Lord, I saw the light. What a privilege that you are born again. In Romans chapter 5, I want to pick it up in verse number 8. But God commanded his love toward us, in that while we yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from him, from the wrath, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. I want to put another bonus scripture here, going back to Genesis. And this is Genesis chapter 3. And I want to read this here from verse number 15. Genesis 3:15, the first gospel. God said, and I put enmity between you and a woman, between your seed and her seed. It shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. He said, I will send someone that's going to destroy the serpent. I will send a redeemer. Praise God. We have a Savior. In Revelation chapter 20, I want to go there quickly. That's Revelation chapter 20. If you want to pick it up in verse number 7. That's Revelation 20, verse number 7. God will allow Satan one last fling. You see, during the thousand-year kingdom, there's going to be billions and billions of people born. No one's going to die except the sinner. They die when they're 100 years old. And all these people living during the thousand-year kingdom cannot be saved because there is no one to tempt them. They will live under a tremendous kingdom. Jesus ruling out of Jerusalem. It's going to be a perfect world, paradise. But you see, every man, a woman, boy, and girl has to make a choice. And that's where you and I made choices to be saved. And when the thousand years is over, Satan will be given the opportunity to go again on the earth with his slick propaganda, his lying tongue. I hate him. And simply tempt the people. Let's read. When 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive nations, which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to get them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand on the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth, compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city, and fire came down from God of heaven and devoured them. If you read Ezekiel chapter 38, 37, 38, and 39, Ezekiel 37, 38, and 39 is a description of the last war at the end of the thousand years. Bible teachers have put that into this time. They are wrong. This is a time for Gog and Magog. It's sad that people have lived for 1,000 years under Christ. Perfect climate, full employment, food to the max, no sickness, just a marvelous time in paradise during 1,000 years. And when Lucifer comes out to talk to them, he's so powerful, so slick, that he will be able to convince them like he convinced the fallen angels. You don't want to serve that Jesus in Jerusalem. You want to be free men, don't you? You want to do what you want to do. You want to be a fag. You want to be a homosexual. You want to be a whore. You want to do all these things, don't you? And they were looking for them and say, yeah, man, let's do it. And they will build an army, second to none. How long this would take place, we don't know. And then, with billions of people in an army, technology to the hilts, they will ascend upon Jerusalem. And that's when God said, okay, devil, you're done. That's it. And fire fell upon the people. They were wiped out, incinerated. And here's the good news. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. That's the end. That's when the devil finally be taken by God's holy angels. All the fallen angels, all demons, will be taken to the lake of fire, where they will be chained, tormented to the max, screaming, yelling as the pain is surging through their spirit bodies that are indestructible forever and ever. And they will look at the devil and say, you, well, I'm not going to say what they're going to call him. You know what I was going to say? You deceived us. You're a liar. And they're going to curse him. And curse it for eternity. Now, the good news is, you and I are going to be with Jesus forever. I want to close very quickly here from Ephesians chapter 6. That's Ephesians chapter 6. Now you know why you're here. To vindicate God. To prove that he is a righteous God. What a privilege that you and I can serve God. And we can say to the devil and his fallen angels, by choice, I received Christ. I didn't have to, but I want to. By choice, I'm a bondservant of Jesus Christ. I will be with him forever. I'm his servant. I'm his slave. I want to be that. I made a choice. You made the wrong choice. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 10, how should we live? Quickly, here's how you should live. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand the evil day, and having done all, to stand. And then the rest of the chapter tells you what it is. This is what we need to do. Now, I've been around for a long time, going to people, being saved. Been a long battle. But I do know this. Every day, I am proving to Satan and to all the fallen angels and to God's holy angels that God is righteous. That's what I'm here. My choice to be saved. That's why you live. That's why you want to walk a holy life. If you read Job chapter 1 and 2, why did Satan attack Job? Because he was bad? No, because he was good. He said, Job is serving God because you give him stuff. And God said, you can have him, but don't kill him. And Job never curse God. If you want to serve God, stop complaining. Stop moaning and groaning. And simply say, to God be the glory. Whatever happened, praise the Lord. I'm going to heaven. I'm showing God's righteousness. I am his servant. That's who we are. And that's why we live on this earth. And it's great to know the purpose. That not God is lonely and simply looking for his companionship. No, he's not lonely. He didn't need us. He created us to prove his righteousness. Let's pray. My Heavenly Father, I just ask right now that every person that listened to me today would understand why they're here, what the purpose is, and what you want us to do. And Lord, thank you for helping us to walk a holy life and to show your righteousness so that everyone in the spirit world would know it, that God is righteous. He's a God of love. And anyone sinning is their problem, not God's. In Jesus' name, amen. If you watch me, you said, I'd like to be saved. As soon as I step off here, Charles Torell would come. He would tell you how to be saved. You stay here for a few seconds. He would read the scripture to you, pray with you, and lead you to Christ. And if you are a believer in Christ, start rejoicing for the privilege of simply advertising to the angelic world that God is righteous. God bless you. We love you. And I pray that you will walk with your head high and praising God all the time. Hallelujah.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking his commandments. That's why he said we've all sinned and fallen short of his standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, Yet peradventure for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commends his love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see, God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with his shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that he sent his own Son to pay a debt he did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send his Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers his love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, he will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, he will do for you. If you call out to him, he will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past. And there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All he wants for you is to come to him. He will help anybody who calls out to him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, he will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. So act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins. on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
Been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the first part in the series, The Responsibility of Mankind, and was entitled Pre-Adamic History. God created the angels long before the universe came into existence. The earth was populated by some type of people before mankind, and there were cities, nations, commerce, and war. The earth was Lucifer's planet, but he did not rule it well. He started an angelic space war that stretched across the universe and left the earth destroyed afterwards. In the subsequent trial, Lucifer and the fallen angels were sentenced to the lake of fire. Lucifer appealed his punishment and questioned how a loving God could condemn him to such a harsh verdict. God responded by granting a stay of execution and placed Adam and Eve on the earth. Humanity came into existence to show the angels that a created being with a free will can reject God and choose to sin. It is not God's fault when that happens. That is the essence of free will. The blame lies with us when we reject God. Most people have no clue as to why they were born and what happens after death. They don't know that a fallen angel named Lucifer has targeted them, and he hates mankind because we are made in the image of God. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1566. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. 3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.